All these photographs of these UFOs are related to the Nazi program in the first place.
The photographs that I took were small models that I built myself just to try out the different types of angles, focal lengths, and viewing projections, and how that relates to other type case files. That's the reason why I created those.
Okay, so the photos that are in Wendell's book, Nazi Flying Discs, are any of those of the genuine article a UFO or a government-created aerospace aircraft? Or are those all models that you have photographed?
They are based off of the drawings from the original German designs. None of them are computer-generated illustrations whatsoever. They're all models.
So you've placed models in the air, filmed them, and those are models of flying discs?
That is correct.
Okay, so they are not actual operating aircraft. They are only models.
That is correct.
Okay, so you were never on any sites while aerospace tests were being made and filming any unidentified flying aircraft?
I have been to Area 51 three times, and I was successful in recording video footage of anomalous craft. I cannot prove they were alien, man-made, or either, but I was at that site at that time. But the aircraft in Wendell's book are models that I built.
Okay, now let's go back.
I want to clarify that.
Are you making it clear to the public that those pictures are of models and actually not of unidentified?
I hope that I've tried to make that clear. In my presentation today, I've specifically stated that a number of the illustrations that were shown were computer-generated forensic composite illustrations. That's similar to this illustration right here. This is the quote-unquote alien reproduction vehicle that was at Norton Air Force Base, November the 12th, 1988. There were three of them there, measuring 24 feet in diameter up to 130 feet in diameter. And this is based off aerospace engineering testimony and eyewitness accounts.
Okay. Now let's run through those photos that you have there and maybe give us a little bit of a background on each of them.
Well, this craft was operational 1960. That's 9 years before Apollo 11. This may explain why Neil Armstrong will not talk about Apollo 11, because there's a high likelihood that he was not the first person on the moon, according to the aerospace literature that we have regarding this particular program. So that's this one. This is an illustration of the U.S. Air Force Jet Flying Wing Disc program, vintage 1946. There were four of these at MacDill Air Force Base, September 1967. They all had tricycle landing gear. There were control surfaces along the circumference of the disc. Unfortunately, this particular program suffered from stability problems, and it was the Air Force's decision to scrap all remaining in this family, with the exception of the four that were at MacDill Air Force Base. But this was an actual flying U.S. Air Force jet disc program. TR-3A Black Manta, it's known as the Manta Ray. It's a Joint General Dynamics McDonnell Douglas program, used as a digital real-time reconnaissance intelligence gathering aircraft during Desert Storm. Had a crew of one. It was a carrier-based operation, could also take land operations. Two air intakes on both sides of the pilot's compartment and a canted vertical stabilizer that's canted inward. So that was the Black Manta, a craft that was seen by over 25,000 eyewitnesses in the Hudson Valley area between 1982 and 1988, all reported a completely silent boomerang manta ray shaped craft that was capable of hovering, very slow flight, definitely a solid UFO case. That's the Hudson Valley.
Do you have any actual photographs as opposed to computer-generated images of this?
I do not have any photographs, but they...
Were there some taken?
There were, and on the Unsolved Mysteries segment, they have video footage of the actual lights themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Here is the cutaway on what we're seeing actually taking place along the B-2's leading edge by positively charging the leading edge of the wing, negatively charging the exhaust gases. There's a resultant drag coefficient reduction up to 60%, and the radar cross-section.
And why is that important?
That's important because we're allegedly told that the B-2 is a subsonic aircraft, but according to this report from Aviation Week Space Technology, they can reduce their drag coefficient by up to 60%, meaning that this could be supersonic and actually have zero sonic footprint.